Welcome back. So far, we have been talking mainly about legacy infrastructure systems. You may have started to wonder about new infrastructure systems. They do not yet suffer from wear and tear, and you may expect them to be well documented in each and every detail. Surely, you would expect such a system to behave more predictably. I'm sorry to disappoint you. For a small system at a very local level, it may be possible to model a system accurately and to predict its behavior. However, most infrastructure systems are much larger and have a tendency to grow continuously as a result of economies of scale and network externalities. Many technologies applied in infrastructure systems are characterized by decreasing cost per unit of output with increasing scale until a certain optimum size of operation. That is why electricity infrastructures are still dominated by large-scale thermal power plants. The growth of infrastructure networks is largely explained by the economic driver to exploit economies of scale, thus making the service more and more affordable for increasing numbers of users. The other driver for network growth is the phenomenon of network externalities. This is the phenomenon of increasing user value with an increasing number of users being connected to the network. Let me give you an example. A telephone connection would be of little value to me if only a few other people have a phone. So anyone connecting to the telephone network or the internet that works in the same way increases the value of that network to other users. Anyone buying a smartphone increases the usefulness of such phones to other people already using a smartphone. It is due to network externalities that once a new infrastructure system takes off, the system tends to grow until the usage of that service is universal, or at least near universal. Economies of scale and network externalities explain why infrastructure systems for energy, transport, telecommunication, and information services have a natural tendency to grow into huge systems, comprising a huge number of subsystems, links, and nodes, all of which are interdependent in several ways. So if one subsystem is not functioning well, this may have far-reaching repercussions on the functioning of the overall system. The interdependency of the subsystems can take various forms, from simple linear dependencies to multiple non-synchronous relationships. The non-linearities caused by feedbacks between subsystems, across system levels, and across timescales are the main cause of emergent behavior of the aggregated system, that is, the system as a whole. As the number of subsystems and interrelationships increases, and as those interrelationships become more diverse, it becomes more difficult to gain an overall view of the system and to know all the feedback loops. Eventually, the system will become so complex that the analyst can no longer recognize or model it at all. Fortunately, though, the emergent behavior of infrastructure systems shows remarkably consistent patterns. Even if I, as an individual user, do not come home at exactly the same time every day, and even though my individual use of electric devices in my home differs from day to day, the aggregated pattern of road congestion and electricity demand during the day is very similar, with slight variations between working days and weekends, and with obviously seasonal variations. These recurrent patterns play a crucial role in the operation of infrastructure systems. Infrastructure operators recognize these patterns and know how to deal with them. They use models that predict how their control actions influence the aggregate behavior of the system, even if they cannot model how this behavior emerges from the interacting elements at the micro level of the system. Obviously, as a user, I don't care since the value of the infrastructure for me is determined by the system's performance at the aggregate level. What difference does it make for me what cables or switches are used, as long as I can make a phone call and watch television in a comfortably heated home? Another factor contributing to the predictability of infrastructure system behavior is path dependency. Since most infrastructures use technologies that are characterized by strong economies of scale, they include many large-scale, capital-intensive installations with an economic lifetime of decades. And this feature implies that the physical system is fairly stable. But also the transportation and distribution networks are capital-intensive. They represent huge sunk costs. Sunk costs are costs that have already been incurred in the past and that cannot be recovered. Even in a tiny country like the Netherlands, which is only 37,000 and somewhat square kilometers, the distribution for networks for electricity, for natural gas, drinking water and sewage each represent more than 100,000 kilometers of underground cables or pipelines to serve its 17 million inhabitants. The high voltage and high pressure transmission networks each reach a length of almost 10,000 kilometers. The cost of these networks cannot be recovered if we were to decide today that it would be smarter to use an entirely different technology. We have made these costs in the past. They were already incurred. They cannot be recovered. So we are dealing with the phenomenon of sunk costs. It is highly unlikely that we would adopt that smart new technology if it would entail the need to build a new network requiring billions of euros of investment. The sunk costs represented by the existing system make it more likely that we will stick to the established system. In other words, technological choices that we made a long time in the past have created a certain path dependency. They dictate many of the choices we make today about expanding and innovating our infrastructure systems. The path dependency created by past technology choices and capital investments does not mean that established infrastructure systems will never become obsolete. If a new technology comes around which promises far better performance, far better value for the user, possibly by an entirely new service, it is likely to be adopted if it can compete with the established infrastructure. A prime example is mobile telephony that requires comparatively small network investments, so it is cost-effective, while bringing unprecedented flexibility in telecommunication and revolutionary new services. Many developing economies around the world have embraced mobile telephony while leapfrogging the expensive copper-wired fixed telephone infrastructure. Developed economies have been slower to adopt the mobile phone and the new services it enables, for instance, mobile money transactions, than, for example, African countries like Kenya. Studies on complex systems often use the concept of agents for interacting elements in the system. In general, an agent is a model for any entity in the system that acts according to a set of rules, depending on input from the outside world. An agent can be an automatic on-off switch in a local control system. It can be a sophisticated software entity that is capable of intelligent control actions. But it can also be a human controller or any other decision maker somewhere in the infrastructure system. By now, it should be clear that our definition of infrastructure does not only refer to the physical network. In our view, an infrastructure system includes besides the transport and distribution networks, the carriers, the conversion and storage facilities, as well as the governance, management, and control systems that are needed to make the system meet its functional specifications and its social objectives. In all parts of this system, social agents, or actors as we call them, are making big and small decisions that influence the behavior of the system. The complexity of infrastructure systems in the social domain is the subject of the next video lecture. Thank you for your attention.